Welcome to the session, Ductility Provisions for Beams. Myself Chetanji Konapure, Assistant Professor, Department of Civil Engineering, Walchand Institute of Technology, Solapur. This is the learning outcome for this session. So student will be able to describe the ductility provisions for the beams, flexural members. Now, what are the ductility provisions and why it is important and what it covers? So this ductility provision covers and applicable to monolithic construction, and second, the building or the structures which belongs to seismic zone 4 and 5. The member which is covered or the structural element which is covered in this session, that is the flexural member. This is the term from IS code. So beam, which is a flexural member, that will be detailed covered in this session. Now let us see the flexural member. So this flexural member beam, which is having breadth and width. So you can see here breadth and the depth. So this is the cross section of the beam. Most important thing in the design of the beam, we are providing the sizes and the sizing of reinforcement also. So geometrical dimensions, the first provision is regarding that. Whatever B by D, the breadth, width by depth of the beam that is selected, it must be always greater than 0.3. Why it is important? Because if we go for smaller width as compared to the depth, provided that member or that beam will become very slender, and slender beam leads to lateral buckling during earthquake excitation. This will be the problem. That's why B by D must be greater than 0.3. So that proper proportioning is important. Next thing is, what shall be B now? Breadth of the section, breadth of the beam, that must be greater than 200. Minimum breadth of the beams must be selected 200. Why it is important? Because the detailing, whatever we are doing, reinforcement detailing in the cross section of the beam, it requires at least 200 mm width. So it is very difficult in detailing for smaller dimensions. That's why 200 mm width is required. Now let us go to now the reinforcement section. First is the longitudinal reinforcement. Most important thing which is specified in IS 3920, that is regarding steel grade should not be greater than Fe415. That is because of, as the strength of steel is increased, provided that will be much brittle. So carbon content of the steel will increase, and it will be not that much ductility we will get. But right now in the market, Fe500, Fe550, these types of steels are available. But one more requirement is specified by the IS, that it shall have elongation more than 14.5%. Though you are using 500 and 550, elongation must be 14.5% more. We want ductility, we don't bother about strength of the steel. Next thing is that most important clause for this longitudinal reinforcement, at least 2 bars on each face throughout the length of the member, because this contributes to safety during reversible of stresses. Stress reversible, that is the major problem in earthquake, and it is happening. So compression to tension, tension to compression, these stress reversible possible at any face of the beam. Now, next thing is regarding the minimum reinforcement. This is also regarding the longitudinal reinforcement or percentage of the steel. Here, the grades of the concretes are specified. As per IS 456-2000, minimum steel is 0.85 divided by Fy. And as per IS 3920, minimum steel is 0.24 FCK or under root FCK divided by Fy. And whatever formulations are given in these two codes, according to that, IS 456 for M20, for 30 and 40, these are the percentage. 0.21% is the minimum steel required. As per 3920, according to the grade, this percentage of steel is increasing. Here for M20 it is 0.26, for M30 0.32, and for M40 0.37%. Now the longitudinal reinforcement, what should be the maximum? Minimum you have specified. In earlier slide, it was tabulated also. So to avoid over-reinforced section and subsequent brittle failure, if you go for over-reinforced section, your section will not yield also. So this will fail in the compression or compressive stresses will be very high, and it will be the brittle failure. So maximum steel ratio, it shall not be greater than 2.5% at any phase. So 2.5% is the maximum reinforcement in this section allowed. Next is positive steel, means steel for the positive bending moment, sagging bending moment. Generally it is at the bottom. At any joint phase, at least equal to half the negative steel. Negative steel means the steel which is calculated for hogging bending moment. Generally it at the joint phase, it is at the top. So the meaning of this statement is the bottom reinforcement at joint phase of the beam must be at least half the top reinforcement at that joint phase. This is the practical meaning of this statement. So it takes care of again the reversible of stresses during earthquake motion. Okay, now the one more clause is important regarding this longitudinal reinforcement, that is steel on any phase at any section at least equal to 1/4 of maximum negative steel. So most important thing is this any section, any phase. It may be your bottom face, it may be lateral vertical faces. The steel must be at least 1/4 of maximum negative steel. Okay, negative steel means the steel at the top at the joint or at the continuous end, whatever negative steel you calculate, steel at the top, its 1/4 must be present at bottom. It 1/4 must be present at least at the vertical faces of the beam. Next is redistribution of the moments not allowed for lateral load. So in case of earthquake load, redistribution of moment is not allowed. Basic philosophy of design is based on inelastic behavior. This is the limitation for not considering the redistribution of the moments. And most important note for you, please note, higher steel does not necessarily mean safety. Most important thing is that provision appropriate of appropriate quantity at appropriate location. That is the only requirement in ductility. Most important point related to this longitudinal reinforcement is the joint face, beam column joint. It may be internal joint, it may be external joint. Now the figure for external joint is shown. This is the beam and its reinforcement that is anchored in the column. So top reinforcement of the beam is anchored, bent actually, and anchored in the column. Bottom reinforcement of this beam is bent and anchored at top, or it is going in the column in upward direction. This will develop the bond of this reinforcement in the column so that there will not be separation of this beam and column at joint face. How much it must be anchored? This is given here. External extension of longitudinal bar from inner face of the column, it must be measured from inner face of the column. Here you start the measurement of this bar length by the amount LD, development length of this bar, plus 10 times the diameter of bar. Suppose this bottom bar is 12 mm diameter, so development length for 12 mm bar shall be calculated plus 10 times the diameter of bar, means 120 mm. So this much must be the anchored length required in this external joint. So, okay, bar bent to accommodate the length. Most important solution for this, you go for larger width of the column, automatically it will solve this anchorage issue. Next thing is internal beam column joint. So bars passed straight through the column to accommodate the length, that is the most important provision for internal beam column joint. Now in case of longitudinal reinforcement, sometimes splicing is required, lap is required. So that splicing shall not be provided for those portion, joint portion, don't go for the splicing. At a distance twice depth of this section from joint face, this is also not allowed. And at a quarter length of the member, so even 1/4 length of the member, means in the joint, in the twice depth from the joint face, even the quarter length of the member, it is not allowed. Where it is allowed, best location is you can provide lap or splicing at midspan of the section. Okay, how much it is? So lap length or splicing shall be done for the length which is having the development, or it must be greater than the development length of that bar. And the hoop spacing shall be less than 150 for the plus spliced portion. So you can refer this figure too. So lap length is shown here at the splice location. This is the splice location, and the transverse reinforcement hoop shall be maximum 150, not more than that. Okay, and here you, in this lap, you only 50% of bars shall be placed. All the bars shall not be placed at one location. This is the criteria, most important criteria. My question for all of you: what is the maximum spacing of hoop in splice portion of the beam? These are the four options. Pause the video, think of that, give the answer. The answer is 150 mm. Now this is about the transverse reinforcement, wave reinforcement. Most important point in this that you should provide this 135 mm hook. First bent 90 degree, again one more bent of 45 degree. So 90 plus 45, that is 135 hook is called. This hook is called as 135 degree. And it must be extended up to 6 times diameter of this bar, or 65 mm, which minimum 65 mm is the anchored, or 6 times the diameter of bar. Okay, so it helps gradual failure of the member, and minimum diameter of hoop bar shall be 8 mm. Now the transfer reinforcement for it must be provided twice the depth of the section from each end. The spacing shall not be greater than the depth of the section by 4 mm. 8 into diameter of smallest longitudinal bar, spacing shall not be less than 100 mm. So all these clauses are explained, and we will see in detail in the sketch also. So this is the sketch where the transfer reinforcement for flexural member is explained. Okay, so this hoop spacing for twice D depth of the section from face, here the hoop shall be D by 4 or 8 diameter bars, whichever is lesser, and at the middle portion the hoop spacing shall not be greater than D by 2. D is depth of the section. All these provisions you can study in this sketch, and according to that the steel or reinforcement shall be provided. Now these are the references for the sections session. Thank you.